Laszlo. Good morning. Happy Thursday. I hope everybody is refreshed and ready for an invigorating day. You've got a busy, busy schedule, a lot of things on the plate, and I'm not going to hold you up. I'm going to jump right into it. I've got 45 minutes to cover a two-hour presentation. I will try to enunciate. I understand this is an English language program. Let me give you a little bit of background about who I am and why I am here, just for some context. So a long, long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, I joined the military, and the military sent me to school, and I had the opportunity to choose between a degree in engineering, or a degree in engineering. So I decided to go off and get a degree in engineering, and when I got out of the military, I found myself in civilian practice at, surprisingly, an engineering firm. Now, the engineering firm was kind enough to name me and three other individuals project directors. So I was in my 20s, and I had this lofty title of a project director, and I had no idea what I was doing, and neither did they. We kind of had responsibilities, and we muddled through the responsibilities with our clients, and we would compare notes. And every once in a while, somebody'd have a nugget of information that was truly valuable. We have this project charter that we're using on this particular project. What is that? Oh, it helps us, sort out the, objectives and the goals that we're supposed to achieve as a result of performing this project. It's like, that's a lovely idea, but what does it matter? Oh, well, they sign off on it, we can hold them accountable. It's like, oh, okay, great, now we're all using project charters. Risk management, oh, what is that? And so on and so forth, you get the idea. And after about 6 or 8 months of comparing notes, we realized there must be a better way. And this was in the late 1990s, or somewhere in there, it doesn't really matter. But we got online, and this is back when the internet was in its early days, and you'd have to dial into the modem, and you'd have to wait for that whirring sound to come through. And we'd go through the channels, and there was this Project Management Institute. And it had just recently published what they called the Project Management Institute's Guide to the Body of Knowledge. Laszlo was just talking about your Hungarian version here. But back then, it was only available in a very thin pamphlet, and you had to put in a check in the mail and a self-addressed stamped envelope so they could return it to you. And 6 to 8 weeks later, we got back this tiny little volume, but it had all sorts of nuggets of opportunity. And I realized that I was really enjoying helping make our projects in the engineering firm work better, more streamlined, more efficient, achieving the goals and objectives that we were supposed to achieve. And I became the de facto go-to person for projects. So let's fast forward a little bit. I come out to California, hit the dot-com boom that was going on at the time and try and make my millions, which never happened. But I found myself working, obviously, in the IT industry. Now, coming from engineering, moving to IT, it's not a direct one-on-one correlation. Now, there's a lot of similarities between the projects, but IT has some additional steps that we don't have in engineering. There's quality control in both of them, but integrated testing, I have no idea what that is. So how do I be successful with this? My boss had asked me if I could do something. I'd raised my hand and said, yes, absolutely, I can do it, but I have not a clue what to do. My local chapter, now the internet was online and you didn't have to dial up through a modem, I found out that the local chapter had a breakfast round table where people could come in and ask a question without fear of being mocked, and other people around the table would help define what possible solutions might be to your challenge. And I ended up being successful, and I moved on into program management and some very large and complex efforts. But I didn't know what I was doing every step of the way. I was reliant on a community to help me be successful. And I found significant value in that, and when the leader of that breakfast round table retired and moved away, there was a void. So I stepped up, I had the opportunity to have that breakfast round table in my offices at the time. I was working with a company that was very generous, and instead of having to pay for breakfast, the company would bring in the breakfast for the participants, and I ran that for about 10 years. And that's my way of giving back to the community that had given me so much and allowed me to be successful. So there's a lot of value in having a chapter. If you haven't tapped into it, consider taking a look at some of the board members that were, you know, introduced and having a conversation with them. The number one reason why most people join a professional organization is networking. And I'll tell you, you're going to have an awful lot of opportunity today to do some wonderful networking. But the best networking experience you can get is being a volunteer. Because when you and I are working together, I get to know you and you get to know me. And if you have a challenge, I'm going to bend over backwards because I know you. You're not just a business card that I have tucked away in my desk. You're a real live person that I've interacted with. So there's potential for you to up your game, if you will. So consider being involved with your chapter. I got involved with my chapter as, you know, the Breakfast Roundtable. I moved on to being on the board, much like Laszlo and the rest of the volunteers here, all of whom were critical for putting this together. So thank you to each and every one of you. And the giving back never ends. PMI ends up being a family. And so I was asked to serve on the board of directors for PMI at the global level, and that's where I am. This is my last year on the board of directors. It's been a wonderful ride. I've had the opportunity to meet a whole bunch of people. I look forward to meeting a whole bunch of you throughout the day. Laszlo and I did some work together at the global level. Golly gosh, it must be about 10 years ago, so we go back a little ways. You know, good friends. That being said, this is why I'm here. And PMI, at the global level, does an awful lot of research. And we invest millions each year in trying to understand what is going on in the world in such a way that we can bring that to you. So if you're not familiar with PMI's Mega Projects Report, I'm going to talk through some of the aspects of the Mega Projects Report. We put this out every year because, not Mega Projects, sorry, Mega Trends. Mega Trends change a little bit from year to year, so I'm going to talk about the current Megatrends report, and the Pulse of the Profession we release every year as well. And the Pulse of the Profession, while the Megatrends talks about the larger ecosystem around the globe, the Pulse of the Profession talks about the discipline and the art and the science of project management and how we perform our work. There's a lot of value in there. I'm only going to touch lightly on it. These are free to download. You don't have to be a PMI member. They have lots of pretty pictures, which if you have senior executive leaders are really valuable because they have the attention of a gnat and it captures them and tells the story in a quick and engaging way. But there's a lot of detail behind it. So I'm going to talk about the six megatrends first. The first one, without great surprise, is digital disruption. Now, this has been going on for quite some time. Digital disruption, you know, encompasses any number of different things. The first and foremost that comes to most people's minds is artificial intelligence. But that's not the only digital disruption. Everybody knows the Airbnb and the Uber stories, but in every industry, there's all sorts of disruptions that are happening where there's new ways of performing work within banking, within medical technologies, you name it, it's happening there. And if you're not cognizant of it as a project leader and understanding what's happening in your industry, you're going to be left behind a little bit. Now, granted, a lot of us rely on our senior executives and our companies to understand what's transpiring, but that's not enough because you are the people on the ground who are leading the efforts that are helping tie the strategy into reality, if you will. So companies come out with ideas, but there may be something lurking around the corner that they may not be aware of, but you can see because you're the person on the ground. But let's talk a little bit about some of the skills that you as project practitioners and that's a fun stage, you as project practitioners and leaders, you know, should consider, you know, gaining a little bit more exposure to. Now, I'm not saying that you have to do deep dives into all of these things, but let's see. Number four, data science skills. So if digital disruption is going to be changing how we perform our work, let's think about machine learning, big data, cloud computing. That requires tremendous amounts of data to be synthesized, and that may help influence your project. Now, if your project is a small little thing, you know, you may not have a need for reliance on big data, but if you're doing a transformation activity or if you're helping build something new for an organization, there may be significant benefits into diving into the data sets. It may be how your customers interact with your software. It may be how a medical device actually transmits data in a meaningful way to a physician who can interpret it in real time and get something back to the patient. But data science skills, I'm not a data scientist, I'm not a data analyst, but my team composition might change a little bit. And I need to know just enough to be able to identify, you know, what's the appropriate skill sets that I need to have on my project team. I may need a data scientist. And I suspect quite strongly that as time progresses, more and more and more of you are going to be reliant not just as much on business analysts and systems analysts as you may need data analysts. So each and every one of these has some implications. Again, the Megatrends report is free to download. It goes into a deeper dive into all of these. I haven't got the time. But I will talk about artificial intelligence because it's usually the number one thing that's on people's minds as they're considering the implications of digital disruption in my project management life. AI, it's going to take my job away. Will it? Absolutely not. And there's a couple of reasons why it won't. Decisions have to be made, and artificial intelligence can provide overwhelming and amazing insights as to what's transpiring in the ecosystem, but it can't make the decisions for you. Now, I like to look at PwC's construct of how artificial intelligence is going to be evolving. I think there's some meat to it. We've already seen some things in our system that are already occurring. So automation, it's fairly simple and straightforward. You know, Microsoft Project, you know, if you indicate that something's going to take a little bit longer, you know, does that mean that we need fewer hours with the resource, and it does that jiggery work inside the program for you? That's all well and good. Integration. So Microsoft Project may be touching base with your human resources system. You know, and if Laszlo is going on vacation for a couple of weeks, what are the implications with the reviews of the data quality sets for, you know, Project X? Do we bring in somebody else to perform those data quality reviews? Do we ask Laszlo to do it up front? What are the implications of him doing it when he gets back from his vacation? But me as a leader, I need to have some say in that. The software shouldn't make that decision, because if the software says, oh, I'm just going to get Tomasz, you know, to do it for me, that may disrupt the, you know, style of my interactions with Laszlo on my team. Laszlo owns that data quality. He doesn't want anybody else touching it. You know, as much as we appreciate Tomasz, no, don't touch my project. So as a project leader, I need to make those calls. Now, granted, the software can learn my preferences. Chatbots, we're already seeing this. You know, I've got a program that I've seen, you know, where it tells me that, you know, Francine is going on maternity leave for 9 months. You know, would, you know, given your preference, you know, what these are the different options. And I can just talk to it and say, I want option A. And it will alert everybody to the changes. It will tell my executive sponsor that I have made this determination. It may say to my executive sponsor, Tony has made the decision to do X. You know, do you approve? And the sponsor will say, yes, I approve. You know, and so the system goes on. So we're seeing that already. What we're not seeing yet is predictive. The problem with predictive, you know, is where it's telling me that, okay, if Francine's going on vacation or on maternity leave for 9 months or whatever the case may be, you know, here are all the ramifications associated with that. The order that was supposed to come in last week is going to be delayed by 2 months. Here are all of the things that you need to do in order to get your project back on track with delivering the quality and the value and the goals and the objectives that were originally intended. In order to get to the predictive stage, we need huge amounts of data specific to the types of projects that you're working on. So if you're, you know, doing a construction project, that's all well and good. If you're doing a construction project on a bridge, that's different than a construction project on a school, which is different than a construction project on, you know, a water refinery plant. So you need huge amounts of data associated with building water refinery plants. And most companies only do so many. So you need collaboration across different, you know, organizations. And most people tend to be a little protective of their data. So the challenge becomes, how do we get an association or a coalition of various organizations to share their data? Maybe they, you know, they scrub it so that it's not identifiable, but it allows them to be competitive amongst their group more than those who are not part of the coalition. So there's some challenges there, and we're nowhere close to being predictive. And then At some point, you know, our jobs will eventually change as project learning through AI becomes a little bit more autonomous. That's probably the better part of 20, 25 years down the road. We'll still need to be, you know, part of the profession and instructive and leading it. They're not taking over the world. But our roles will change, and they're already changing. I like to talk more about project leaders than I do about project managers. It's more about leading the project and helping define the path forward and helping inspire your staff and the people on your team to be productive. All right, so that was one. One out of six. We've got five more to go. The climate crisis. We're all keenly aware of that. What does that have to do with me and my work? You know, on a daily basis, maybe not that much. But if we look at the future of project management and what it's going to mean, it means that we're going to need to address, you know, the impacts of climate change on our environment. That means that if you're in a coastal, you know, environment, you may need to build more levees, or you may need to shore up where your docks boat, because rising sea levels mean that, you know, where we've currently got them, we need to construct, you know, the seawall so that it meets the rising tides. There's a whole panoply of implications associated with this, and when I say that Project Management Institute invests millions of dollars, I'm not kidding. We look at, you know, information that we're receiving from, you know, sources through our Global Executive Council, from, you know, our peers in the field. We solicit our practitioners, but we also use other resources, and we have data analysts who are world class, you know, Central Intelligence Agency type analysts who can take this wide array of information and synthesize it down into meaningful stories. This is just one of a deck of about 500 slides, and I'm just choosing this one because when we think about how the future of project management is going to change, when we talk about where water is going to be shifting as a result of climate change, what are the implications of that? Okay, so we don't have so much rainfall in California as we used to, but it's shifting elsewhere. We're getting more rainfall, for example, in Western Africa. But where the water falls is where people tend to go. But we've got cities that already exist in areas where water is diminishing. So there's two types of projects there. The projects for helping the existing, you know, environments and populations have the water resources that they require. That's going to require project managers to run projects associated with those efforts. But then as water is falling in other places, especially when we pull in, you know, how the demographics of the world are shifting and where people are, where populations growing and shifting, there's going to be a need to build environments for them. So they're going to need new schools. They're going to need roads to get to those schools. They're going to need homes. They're going to need hospitals. They're going to need, you know, water supply basins, all of those sorts of things. So if you're in the construction industry, for the foreseeable future, your profession is given. It's tight. It's golden. You're going to have a lot of work. But this applies to all of our disciplines, all of the various professions within project management. Because, you know, when you're building a new school, there's going to be a need for the computer software, and somebody's going to have to build the computer software that helps with all of these sort of things. But there are implications. Number three, economic shifts. So, as we know, especially following COVID, I don't know if you experience here in Hungary, I am married to an architect, and I get stories on a daily basis about how since COVID had hit and the implications associated with the disruption of supply chains, you know, to order a window for an addition in a house now takes 2 months to get that window. Now it's 4 months. Now it's 6 months. At present, it can be up to a year just to get a window built to put into a new house. So the implications of this for, you know, your organization may vary significantly. But there's a number of things that you want to take into account. Those are shown on this slide. Now, again, the Mega Projects Report goes into a deep dive on each of these items. And some of them make a certain amount of sense, but there's investments in this that are required. And again, you know, you may be sitting there saying, hey, I'm just a project manager. What does this have to do with me? Well, if you're a project leader, you're having an influence on how your organization has conversations about how its projects can be successful. And if you've got supply chain implications with the work that you're doing, if you're building computer chips, you know, you need certain elements to get into the factory in such and such a quantity so that you can be able to meet your production runs. And that may be a little function of product management, which plays along with project management. That's a whole nother conversation for a whole nother day. But these are some of the things that you may want to consider getting to know a little bit more about. And again, the Mega Projects Report, I encourage you to download it. It gives you a whole lot more detail. Demographic shifts. Now, this is one where Hungary, you know, is probably a little more keenly aware than much of the rest of the world. You know, but increasing fertility in certain areas and declining fertility in other areas is having an impact on where we get our resources for our project teams. And understanding, you know, where we can get those resources is of critical importance. But just by way of illustrating, on a global level, you know, we're seeing a population growth decline. And I'm just going to point out, you know, worldwide, 0.6 is right around 2047. The United States, we see that 0.6 has just happened. But everybody I trust is kind of aware of what's going on in Japan. Hello, Japan. Oh, there we are, Japan. Japan has hit that 0% where their population is declining about 20 years ago. And Hungary, you hit that about 40 years ago. So the implications of where do I get resources is a conversation that project teams need to have, project leaders need to be in front of. If I've not got the pool of prospective candidates within my country, I'm going to have to pull them from someplace else. Okay, we get that. But there's a whole skill set associated with leading those people who come from different regions, who come from different cultures. You know, the simplest one, you know, is in California. You know, we employ a lot of Indian contractors. You know, never mind the time zone difference, which is about 12 and a half hours. You know, there's visual indicators. You know, we're very kind, we get up very early, and they're very kind, they stay up very late. And, you know, when we say, can you do this? And they say, yes, we can. You have to get past, you know, that there's, you know, a visual cue there that's a little different. You know, but this can be even more localized. You know, the French, you know, may say yes, you know, to something when in reality what they mean, what they're trying to telegraph, if you're a French person, you know that yes means, okay, maybe, let's talk about it some more. But, you know, every culture is a little different. So understanding that is important and getting in front of it and having those critical conversations with your team and across the board with your resources is an important, you know, skill set to develop. And we talk about this in another piece of research called the talent gap. And where there's a need for project management practitioners all over the course of the next 10 years, we need to build up about, oh, let's see, I've got the numbers here somewhere. No, I don't have it here. It's in the report. About 27.5 million a year new practitioners, you know, because we're seeing people as the aging population, you know, continues, retire. I'm getting ready for retirement, you know, but we need more new people in our industry. So it's important for, you know, membership associations like the PMI Budapest chapter, you know, to create compelling offerings that help people understand that project management's a fun field. I love project management. That's why I'm not an engineer anymore. I love seeing things go from an idea into a reality. It just makes my blood go pumping. Labor shortages is obviously associated with this. You know, and so, oh, and here's the numbers. Oh, 27.5, I was so close, 25 million. But 2.3 million annual job openings. So there's a lot of need. Now, if we don't fill that gap, and the Project Management Institute is working to fill that gap, obviously, we're advocates for the importance of project management and, you know, how satisfying it can be as a career path. We're also seeing shifts in the project economy where people may be a project manager one day, then they're going to be a business analyst the next day, you know, and then they're going to be a systems lead the next day, and it morphs. So there's shifts in how the economy of projects is working. People move from company to company to company more than they ever have historically. So we're investing a lot in this, but it comes down to you as project leaders, you know, to say, you know, if I'm going to be leading, you know, a team of 25 project managers because I've moved on to being a PMO director and that sort of thing, I need to be aware that I need to be invested in helping our larger community understand the value and building that talent pool up. Now, our sixth one, and this is the last of the mega projects, and I've still got the other report, the Pulse of the Profession, to go through, is an interesting one. So, you know, social equity, unrest, you know, people protesting in the streets about, you know, any number of different topics may seem like something that's worthy of some news, but how does it affect our profession? And it's a little challenging to draw the line, but what we're seeing is that all these protests that continue to happen are developing into movements that governments and companies are recognizing as valuable and something that they want to get behind. So if I want to attract labor to my company, I may want to have a social stance that is attractive to the new demographic. And if I'm attractive to that new demographic, I need to walk the walk. I can't just say it. You know, people know when you're just saying it. So I have to build a program. I need to build or be associated with projects that actually help, you know, ameliorate the deleterious effects of whatever wrong is out there, or that help support, you know, the opportunities for the disenfranchised. Whatever the talking points may be, you know, we can't be silent. And there's project work that has to be that has to happen as a result of that. So there's this whole new ecosystem that's emerging as a result. So the classic project paradigm is going out the door. Digital disruption, labor shortages, supply chain issues, the interest in backing social, you know, and equity opportunities, all of which plays into how we're going to deliver value slightly differently than we've historically been told, you know, we're going to do it. And we're ready for that. Each and every one of us has been through the pandemic. We know that we're capable of shifting how we do our work. I just want to share with you these six things because they play into what's coming next. And if you're not already aware of it, I highly recommend that you do a little additional research just so that you've got your head wrapped around the potential, and most importantly, how it may or may not affect your individual work as you progress as a project leader. Let's let somebody else talk for a minute.
When I look ahead of the future, I think that the biggest challenge will be understand really the work of artificial intelligence and where is the place for project managers and people working in project.
The changes of project management processes, the changes of the way project managers work will definitely be more reliant on technology.
And that's going to increase the importance of how people work together and collaborate. And it's going to grow an increasingly important component of personal skills, collaboration skills, and leadership skills that go above and beyond the traditional technical skills of project management.
But we need to prepare the machines to deliver our projects better so we're not doing the repetitive tasks ourselves. So we're not reactive to the market, we create the next market of project management.
The future of project management is, I would say, disrupted. Fast delivery, compressed cycles, as well as fast failure, if that is the case.
Leading business with agility. Any future development should reflect that.
I think in future of project management, it will be more agile and more business related.
Because these days we talk about value. In order to understand the value of that project, you need to understand the business. You gotta have the technical management skills, the leadership skills, but also understand the business.
In a global environment, it's going to be more diverse cultures coming into the workplace. Therefore, a different take on skills, different time zones, totally different business practices. So you need to plan for those challenges.
We need to take care of our environment, to take care of our planet, to go for sustainable projects, projects that take care of the human being.
When we talk about DevOps and we talk about Agile, I'm asked, do you those kind of methodologies strip away the need for a project manager? I think absolutely not. I think we are in need of even more project managers in the future. We are getting more and more project oriented in our businesses, in our societies.
artificial intelligence will take some of the jobs, but I think they cannot be a leader. So as a project manager, if you are a good leader, you are going to continue to perform your profession.
So as project managers, we have to get better at leading teams and leading people, working with people, and find ways to include automation in what we do while still maintaining our human aspect, our humanity.
It's difficult to see something clear in the future, but we should stay prepared to face with flexibility new challenges, new situations. Be prepared to change into something completely different.
All right, so there's a lot to unpack there. And everything that has been said in that video is echoed in the Pulse of the Profession report. The ways of work are changing, how organizations react to their environments and lead towards success is changing. The need to be adaptive is becoming more embedded in organizations so that they can be transformative and so that they can pivot as needed in order to meet whatever shifts in the environment are occurring. And those shifts are increasing and they're becoming more and more impactful. And how we lead project teams, and I like Randy Black's little bit there about, you know, the need for humanity and keeping that in there is a critical element. So I like Peter Hinson. Peter Hinson is a futurist, and he uses the term never normal. And I like the term never normal because I'm asked all the time, all right, so we've gone into the COVID pandemic and everything kind of got transformed. You know, what is normal going to look like again? What is the new normal? And Peter Hinson, I think, hits the nail on the head, if you're familiar with that idiom. You know, he has got the correct answer. There will never be a new normal. It is always going to change, and we need to be aware of that. We need to be mindful of that, and if we get complacent, we're going to be left behind. And so our job as project leaders is to be continually aware of what's going on in the environment and to educate ourselves. I've already talked a little bit about how, you know, the world of work is changing with regard to how people interplay. It used to be that we used to have a career path within an organization. It was fairly well defined and we knew where we were going. Now it's shifting. You know, we're all over the place. You know, the function of teams and how they get comprised and where they go next, you know, is not just something for some human resources administrator. We as project leaders, you know, need to know what's going to be next on our horizon if we're managing a portfolio of projects, being able to place people in such a meaningful way that they derive value from it. You know, they're not just workers, you know, they're people, and we need to be cognizant of their needs. And if we are not adept at that as a skill, as a leader, we're going to fall behind and people aren't going to want to work on our teams, and that's critically important. Running a little low on time, so I'm gonna quickly go through, you know, these are four things that I've pulled out of the Pulse of the Profession report that I personally think are the most critical aspects in order for project practitioners to be effectual. So understanding complex problem solving. So PMI does have an offering. If you're not familiar with it, it's called Wicked Problem Solving. But really what it is it's a course in design thinking. And design thinking is geared towards helping tease apart how to approach a problem and get a team to get behind how to move forward on making that resolution come to pass. And that's part of getting things done. That's kind of talking to itself. Transformation readiness. Transformation, you know, came to be kind of the kind of new term. Every organization is going to have to go through an organizational transformation. We do that, we get that, and every organization by and large has. And they've coined the chief transformation officer in a lot of organizations, and I remember thinking to myself, you only need to transform once, right? You need to get yourself from this, you know, old, you know, ways of working to this new digital environment. And the reality is I'm wrong. I'm very, very wrong in my thinking there. We transform all the time. We're going to continue to transform as new technologies, as new shifts in the environment come into play. We need to be adept and on top of that. So having some familiarity with the unique aspects of how that may interplay with projects and how you perform your delivery efforts is important, and that goes into agility as well. All right, so most of you are familiar with the talent triangle, I hope. For those of you who are not, PMI put that into place some many years ago. It used to be when you got your professional certification that you were required to continue to learn, you know, so you'd report your professional development units, your PDUs, and it didn't really matter on what, you know, field it was. And at some point, we talked to senior executives, and they said, oh, well, you know, the technical skills are all well and good, and they're an important and crucial aspect of our project management communities and our organizations, but what we need is for our project managers to be project leaders, you know, which is why I keep harping on that term. And so we built the talent triangle to recognize, you know, that we needed technical skills, we needed, you know, business and strategy skills, and then we needed some leadership skills there as well. And all of those, you know, are embedded, you know, in the slide here. But this is the one where it's got all the words on it. And we've kind of changed the phrasing of the talent triangle recently. Hopefully you're aware. It's been out for the better part of a year now. Where in the middle, ways of working used to be technical project management. It's so much more than technical project management. The ways of working encompass that design thinking element that I was mentioning earlier. Digital transformation, or any kind of transformation. It doesn't necessarily have to be digital. And it requires a lot of the, you know, traditional skill sets as well. But those continue to evolve. You know, and if we need, I've learned risk management 101 25 years ago. You know, but there's risk management 102, and there's risk management 201, and then there's master series in risk management. If my job entails having a heavy emphasis on that, I need to continue to upskill. But more importantly, you know, having an understanding of the business environment, you know, the strategy and business world in which we operate, and allows us to communicate with our senior leaders about what's happening on the ground, allows us to make better decisions that support the strategy and the efforts for achieving goals and objectives, and in my mind's eye, the most important are the power skills. Now, we used to call them soft skills. Most of you are probably familiar with that term. Soft skills is a soft phrasing. It doesn't really embellish how critically important they are to our success as project leaders. And I adore that we've chosen to use the term power skills instead. And these are the ones that you really need to, you know, ensure that you've got down if you're going to be a project leader. All right, so I'm not going to harp on that too much. Your key takeaways for today are these three items here, if I may. Upskilling, continuous learning. If you're not always improving, if you're not aware of the environment that's going on around you, you're not going to be successful for the next iteration of what's coming next. And there's a lot coming down the pike. So that Megatrends report, give it a good once over. Take some time to consider for yourselves, is this something that has the potential to impact the way work is done in my organizations? And if so, what kind of dialogue should I be having in my organization? With whom should I be having these dialogues? And what else do I need to learn in order for my project teams and my organization as a whole to be successful? Secondly, adapting your way of work. Use the approach that works best for the context. You know, I love my Agile purist friends. Agile works on everything. I'm a traditionalist, you know, predictive project management, that was my bread and butter for a long time. I'm very comfortable in that space. But I recognize that hybrid approach, you know, oftentimes works best. In some areas, you know, Agile is absolutely the right way to go. In other areas, Agile is no bueno, is no good. We need predictive in order to absolutely ensure, you know, that we've got the tight controls in place that we require for this. So understanding that not one way or another is perfect for everything is important. I think we all kind of know that inherently, but we need to make sure that we're practicing it and that we're learning the new ways of working that are out there that we can employ, add to our toolbox so that we can be successful. And lastly, projects are how work gets done. Now that may seem obvious, but it's an important conversational piece to have with our senior executive leaders. And if you're adept at being able to describe that, you know, no strategy, is successful without projects and programs and a portfolio of work to help that strategy be enabled. You know, too many organizations, we were just talking about this in the other room, you know, are really good at making a strategy. They bring in consultants and they've got this idea of what we're gonna do and how we're gonna do it, where we're gonna play, and then they throw it over the wall, you know, to somebody who doesn't understand, you know, how to operationalize the strategy, how to execute on that strategy. And strategies get accomplished through project work. That all being said, I'm going to stop because I'm out of time. I'm going to have a little Q&A, I think, later on in the day. I want you to hopefully take some of these ideas, think about them, and as the day progresses, consider what the other speakers are saying and how this might apply, you know, to what you take away today. And I wish you all the very, very best with your day. Thank you very much.